to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. Welcome to our study of living messages of the Old Testament. In this series of lessons, we want to do several things, but as we think about Genesis, we want to look at the great characters, God's hand of creation, and we want to familiarize ourselves with the book. But in these lessons, more importantly, we want to ask, what does Genesis, what does Exodus, what do these great books of the Old Testament teach us today? How can they help me to live for God and live for Christ better? And friend, that's exactly what the New Testament says these books can do. Romans 15:4 says the things that were written before time, specifically the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, was written for our learning that we, through patience and comfort, might find hope. These Scriptures, these Old Testament lessons, can teach us great lessons about God, about man, and about the hope that we have as a child of God. And just as important as looking at the practical aspect of Genesis or Leviticus or whatever book it may be, we want to see Christ in the Old Testament. It's been said that if you don't see Christ in the Old Testament, you've missed the whole point. And friend, that is so true. The Bible teaches us in Galatians chapter 3, verses 24 through 26, that the law was our tutor, bringing us up to Christ. Romans chapter 7 says Christ is the completion or the end of the law. And so the great book of Genesis will teach us many practical lessons, and we'll see glimpses and pictures of Christ along the way. But as we think about the book itself, the key word and the key phrase in the book of Genesis would be the word beginning or in the beginning. It's all about origins. You've got the beginning of man, the beginning of the world, the beginning of language, the beginning of sin. A host of things begin with this great book. And so it's about origins or beginnings. Key verse of Genesis would be Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. And this is really pointing us, even at the early stages, toward Christ Himself. I want you to notice what Genesis 3 verse 15 says. The Scripture says, "And I, God speaking, will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." Here God's talking to that serpent, to Satan, and He says, "I'm going to put division, enmity between you. The seed of woman is going to bruise your head." There's that death blow dealt by the seed of woman, none other than Jesus Christ Himself. And so in the initial stages, we see that hope. We see God working towards salvation. Key chapter to the book of Genesis would be Genesis chapter 3. Here you've got Adam and Eve in the luscious garden. They've got everything they need, everything they want, and God, there He gives them everything they need, but they decide they need more. They want to be like God, and so they eat of that forbidden fruit. Sin enters the world, and God begins to plan for hope from that time forward. If we were to outline the book of Genesis, we could say that Genesis uniquely divides into two categories. You've got the book of beginnings, Genesis 1 through 11, where we have multiple origins, multiple things that start. Man, creation, the world, marriage, sin, languages, the flood. And then you've got the book of the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, Genesis 12 through Genesis chapter 15. So a very unique, very easy way to remember the book of Genesis. You've got four great events that occur in this first category. When we talk about the book of beginnings, there are four things that are very unique to this section. You've got the creation. Friends, this world that we live in It's not an accident. It didn't start by evolution. There wasn't a big bang and somewhere, somehow, out of some cesspool of nothing, everything came to exist. The world was created by supernatural power, by the power of God. God spoke and the world came into existence. God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. God said, "Let us make man in our image," and man became a living being. Genesis 1, verses 26 and 27. And so you've got the creation of the world. You've got the creation of man. You've got the creation of woman. You've got the creation of marriage. And so the first powerful event is the creation of all things. And then, as God has created man, man enters into sin. Genesis 3 and 4, we have the sin of Adam and Eve entering into the world. They see that forbidden fruit. They look at its beauty. They think that it will make them like God. They see that it will make them wise. And so as they eat of that, they break God's commandments and sin there enters into the world. Now, we're not talking about Adamic sin where because of Adam, all of us are now sinners, but they open the door. And Romans 5 verse 12 says that all of us have gone through that same door. One man sinned, yet sin entered into the world because all sin. Romans 3 verse 23, Romans 5 verse 12. And then the world became so steeped in sin, so wicked in iniquity, that God decided He'd had enough. Genesis 5 through 10, we have this period where God now is ready to destroy man. Man has become wicked, yet Genesis chapter 6 tells us that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Noah and his family are told to build that great ark. God sends the flood. God rescues them. And from Noah and his descendants, pointing again towards Christ, the rest of humanity comes. And then you have the event in Genesis chapter 11. The Tower of Babel. The people have become proud again. They want to be like gods. They begin to build this big tower. And God begins languages to confuse them, to show them He's still in control. He's still in power. And so the initial chapters of Genesis show us God's power, but they show us the mistakes that man begins to make, and here we see the glimpses of Jesus coming through. And then in Genesis 12 through 50, that second category, the book of the patriarchs, we now have mentioned four great figures who we'll see through the rest of this book. Abraham, friend of God, great man to whom the promises are made. His son Isaac, that son of promise. Jacob, who from his first day, first moment into the world, had his hand wrapped around his brother's ankle and has always been trying to pull himself up. And then Joseph, that great man of God, who trusted God's providence, whom God worked through to save his family, and who we see as a great servant in the house of God. You know, as we think about these four men, Abraham stands out as a great friend of God. When we think about Abraham, what do we think about? We think about a man who trusted God. Can you imagine being in Abraham's situation? God, in essence, says to Abraham, "Pack your belongings, put them in the truck. When you get ready to go, I'll tell you where you're going." Could you do that? Do you have the faith? Do we have the trust of Abraham? Look at the great promise God makes to Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, beginning in verse 1. The Bible says, "Now the Lord had said to Abram, 'Get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, and in you all families of the earth shall be blessed.'" Abraham was a man of trust. God said, "Get up and go," and Abraham went. He was willing to do exactly what God said. Friends, as we think about practical lessons, here's how it's so practical today. Like Abraham, I need to trust God fully. I may not always can see the end. I may not know how things will always work out, but I know who is in control. Proverbs 3 verses 5 through 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him in all your ways, and He'll direct your paths." God's in control. God knows far better what I need, and if I will only trust God, take Him at His word, you can be sure God will always lead us in the best direction. Think about the words of Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6. The Scripture says, "Let your life be without covetousness, for He has said, the Lord has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you, so that you may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, what can man do to me?" How we today need to walk in the footsteps of Jesus, 1 Peter 2:21. We need to have the mind of Christ, Philippians 2 verse 5, and we need to trust God fully. What else made Abraham a great man of God? Abraham was a friend of God because he obeyed God. There's so many people today who think that they can have this warm, fuzzy feeling and that somehow Jesus lives in their heart and yet live in absolute disregard for what this book says. Do I have to obey the will of God to be a friend of God? Well, let's look at what God said to Abraham. Look in Genesis chapter 26 and notice what verses 4 and 5 say. The Scripture says, God speaking, "I will make your descendants multiply as the stars of the heaven. I will give to your descendants all these land, and in your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed." Why? Because Abraham obeyed my voice, kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my law. Here God's talking to Isaac and says, look at what your father did. Here's the reason all these blessings are going to happen. Friend, if I'm going to be blessed by God, if you're going to be blessed by God, you have to obey Him. There's no way around that. Listen to what Jesus said. Jesus said, "If you love me, do what you want." No, that isn't what Jesus said. Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments." John 14, verse 15. Jesus said in Matthew 7, verse 21, that it's not everybody who looks up into heaven and says, "Lord, Lord," that's going there, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Think about the haunting question of Luke 6, 46. Jesus said to the pious Pharisees, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say?" And then I'm reminded of the words of Hebrews 5, verses 8 and 9. Jesus is the author of eternal salvation to all who obey Him. If I'm going to please God, if I'm going to learn lessons from these great texts of the Bible, friend, I've got to learn. I must obey God to please Him. And then we notice the covenant that God made with Abraham. I want you to look at the words of Genesis chapter 15 and see this great promise, this great contract, we might say, that God makes with Abraham. Beginning in verse 4, the Scripture says, "And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir," speaking of Ishmael, "but one will come from your own body, shall be your heir. Then he brought him outside and said, look now toward heaven, count the stars, if you're able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be." And here's that great statement. "And he believed in the Lord, and he accounted it to him for righteousness." Now, friends, there is no direct descendant of Abraham and Sarah. That promise has been made to them, and yet before the child is born, because of who God is and because of what God's done, Abraham believed God. Doesn't mean he just knew God would do it, but he trusted to the point he was willing to change his life and live that way. When we talk about God making a covenant or a promise, hasn't God done that with us? 1 John 2 verse 25 says, "This is the promise He's promised us, eternal life." The Scripture says, John chapter 14, Jesus said, "I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." There's a promise. There's a covenant, we might say, God's made. God has promised that those who walk in the light, 1 John 1, 7, those who are washed in the blood of the Lamb, Romans 6, 1 through 4, and those who live a life of purity can one day live in heaven. And friend, if I will believe, and I'm not just talking about, I say to myself, well, sure, that's a fact, I believe that. If I'll change my life to the point that I faithfully follow God every day, just as sure as Abraham became the father of many nations, so we can inherit that wonderful place called heaven. But you know, as we think about Abraham, great man of God, friend of God, one who obeyed God's voice, Abraham had a weakness. Genesis chapter 12, verse 10 following, he was afraid of what others might do to him because of the beauty of his wife, and he lied. He did the same thing in Genesis chapter 20 and verse 2. He again becomes afraid. What's going to happen to me? What are people going to do to us? And so he lied. Abraham, although he was a friend of God, had a problem. And that problem was he was afraid to tell the truth, or at least he told half-truths and half-lies at different times in his life. And so when we think about Abraham, we also need to realize that none of us are above sin. Abraham was a great man of God, and yet he made mistakes. We too make mistakes. Let's realize today, we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Let's realize that the wages of our sin is death. As I think about Abraham, his powerful example, I realize as well that Abraham was separated from God at times because of sin. The Bible says in Isaiah 59 verses 1 and 2 that the Lord's ear is not heavy that He cannot hear, His arm's not shortened that He cannot save. But your sins, your iniquities, your trespasses have separated your God, you from your God. The soul who sins shall surely die. Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 4. Then we think about Isaac, the child of promise. Isaac has this same promise given to him just as his father Abraham did. He believes that, and yet at times Isaac also made mistakes, just like his father did. He also had a little trouble with lying as well, and yet God worked through these men. He worked through Isaac to bring the seed promise to pass. That same promise is reiterated to Abraham in Genesis 22, verses 17 and 18, that through his seed, who is Isaac, he was going to bless all nations. He was going to multiply their blessings upon the face of the earth. And so Isaac now is the one that God is working through to bring the promised Messiah into the world. Now that son of promise, you remember Isaac? God said, take your son, your only son, up to the mountain and sacrifice him. And do you remember the journey up the mountain? As they're going up the mountain, the lad asks, here's the wood, where's the lamb? Do you remember Abraham's response? God will provide. Abraham was so convinced that Isaac was the son of promise that according to Hebrews chapter 11, that even if he killed him, he believed God would raise him from the dead. Abraham, Isaac, great men of God whom God was working through. And then we have Jacob. Jacob and Esau. Jacob is a great character in the Old Testament in that he was willing to pull himself up by his bootstraps, we might say. He comes out of the womb, his brother's ahead of him, and yet he comes out and his hand is around Esau's ankle. And from that time forward, he's trying to get God's blessing. He's trying to get a leg up, we might say, and God uses Jacob in his plan and for his purpose, as you see throughout the Old Testament. And then, of course, we have Joseph as well. Joseph would be that fourth and great character in the book of Genesis through whom God's providence worked. You remember the story of Joseph? Joseph is the youngest. His brothers are jealous of him because of some of the visions that he has. His brothers, at an opportune time, take him, they throw him in a pit. They take his coat, put blood on it, give it back to his father. His father now believes he's dead. He's left in that pit initially, but then a band of Midianites comes along. And his brothers begin to see dollar signs. And so they get him up out of that pit and they sell him to the Midianites. He's sold into slavery pretty much. That band of Midianites goes into Egypt, and lo and behold, Potiphar, who is second in command to Pharaoh, buys Joseph. He's in Potiphar's house. He rises up to a great status. But then Potiphar's wife begins to look at Joseph with longing eyes. Every day, it says, she begins to test him, to tempt him, lie with me. He won't do that. Up to the point that he leaves his garment in her hand and runs out of the house. She's embarrassed and cries rape, but Joseph is still determined to do the right thing. He now ends up in prison. The butler, the baker are there. Joseph is there. He interprets certain visions and dreams, and before you know it, he's up and out of the prison, and he is second in command only to Pharaoh himself. he now has an opportunity not just to be an example in Egypt, but to save his own family in the midst of the famine. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20 is a great verse about Joseph and his faithfulness. Joseph, looking back at all the events that occurred, says to his brothers, "You meant it for evil. God turned it out for good." God is able to take that which we may see as evil and bad, and as Romans 8:28 says, He works all things together for good to those who love the Lord, to those who are called according to His purpose. But now let's look at that third aspect we want to see in these living messages of the Old Testament. Where do we see Christ in the book of Genesis? I know Christ hasn't come to the world yet. I know we're not in the New Testament age where Christ lived. Is Christ in the book of Genesis? You bet He is. He's there at the very beginning. You remember that great passage, Genesis 1:1? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Did you know that Jesus was an active agent in creation? Look at John chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. The Scripture says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made that was made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of men." Just like Colossians 1:15, Jesus is there at creation. God is using Him in that process. And so we see His hand in creation. We see Jesus as the ultimate seed of woman. The promise is made to Abraham. That promise transcends through Isaac. That promise works through many people. But the promise ultimately is through Christ. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, when God says, "The seed of woman will crush the head of Satan," who's that talking about? Look at Galatians chapter 3 and verse 16. The Scripture says, "Now to Abraham and to his seed were the promises made, and he does not say, and to seeds as of many, but as of one." And notice, "and to your seed, who is Christ." The promise made in Genesis 3:15, the promise made in Genesis chapter 12, Genesis chapter 22, verse 17 and 18, that same promise ultimately made to David in 2 Samuel 7, verses 12 through 14. Who's that all about? We're talking about the descendants of Abraham, the Jews? No, he doesn't say seeds as of many, as of one. "And to your seed, who is Christ." And so we see Christ as the ultimate seed of woman, both God and man, humanity and deity coming to earth to destroy the works of Satan. And then we see Christ in Genesis chapter 12 as that great promise is made to Abraham. Who fulfills that promise? Well, the Jews viewed that promise as fulfilled. They viewed the land promise, the land of Canaan, as the ultimate rest and the blessing that Abraham gave to the Israelite nation. But such is not the case according to Galatians 3, verse 29. The Scripture says this, "And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." What promise? That promise that He would bless all nations wasn't just a land promise. That's the promised blessing that if men and women live faithful to God, Revelation 2 verse 10 says, "Be faithful unto death, and I'll give you the crown of life." It's the ultimate hope we have of heaven. I don't have to be a Jew. I don't have to be a descendant of Abraham. If I'm a child of God, I have just as much right and just as much hope to that great promise. God will bless me and bless you just as He did the Israelites as they followed Him. But then there's one more picture of Christ we want to see, and that's in Genesis chapter 49 and verse 10. Notice what the Scripture says here. The Bible says, "The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh comes, and to him shall be the obedience of the people." Here you've got that great promise that the scepter, the lawgiver, is going to come. He's going to come from Judah. Hebrews 7 says it's evident. Our Lord came out of Judah. Jesus is of the tribe of Judah, and He is the lawgiver. He gave us the great law of liberty today. James chapter 1, verses 21 through 22. "And Jesus is still holding the scepter. The scepter is a symbol of kingship, power, and authority. And friends, Jesus is right now reigning at the right hand of the Father in heaven. And so as we've thought about Genesis, a great book that tells us God created us and that God wants to and is willing to bless us if we're willing to follow Him faithfully. Have you done that? Are you a child of God? Friend, why would you want to miss out on the hope and the joy of heaven? Why would you want to miss out on all spiritual blessings that are ours in Christ Jesus? Just like the great promises made to the patriarchs, we have the promise of one day living with God in heaven forever. If you're not a child of God, we encourage you today to become one. Will you hear the Word of God? The Bible says to become a Christian, you first must hear God's Word. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Once you've heard this Word and you realize it is God's truth, will you then believe that? Jesus said in John chapter 8 verse 24, unless you believe that I am He, you'll surely die in your sins. Will you believe so much so that you change your life and repent? Acts 3 verse 19, Peter preached, repent and turn again that your sins may be blotted out. Jesus said in Luke chapter 13 verses 1 through 5, unless you repent, you'll all likewise perish. Repentance is a changed will that leads to a changed way. Would you change your way of thinking and change your way of acting to God's ways? Would you make that great confession that the Ethiopian eunuch did? I believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, Acts chapter 8, verses 36 through 39. And would you today be baptized in water to have the hope of heaven? Here's how plain Jesus made it. Jesus said, he that believes and is baptized will be saved. He that does not believe shall be condemned. The Bible teaches baptism does now also save us. If you've not obeyed the gospel, we beg you to today, in view of the hope of Christianity, the joy of living a life with real meaning and purpose, won't you today make it right with God so that one day you can ultimately live in heaven? You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wife.
This is the gospel. We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905. Or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111. This is the gospel of Christ.